Amen.
Amen.
Awesome. I just got the distinct impression spiritually that I just got plugged into the wall. You know how when your phone's about dead, you plug it in and it goes bling like this and it lights back up and got plugged back into that energy source. Thank you. Thank you. Welcome to worship at Aldersgate. I think that it's the fourth Sunday after lunch. What do you say? Is coming. So good to have all of you here this morning. And thank you for sharing your prayer requests with me here in the week. Thank you for filling out the joys and concerns of the back of the room when you came. So with that said, let's be in an attitude of prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
Even though I walk through the valley, the darkest valley,
I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Now please hear the scripture lesson from the Old Testament prophet Isaiah.
Today's scripture lesson is from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 27 to 31. Why do you complain, Jacob? Why do you say, Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord. My cause is disregarded by my God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even the youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint.
We ask, God, that you would allow through the presence of your Spirit us to meditate on the words, that you would use me, allow me to think and to speak clearly, and that you would apply the message right into our own lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So I have to get the lay of the land in the room this morning before we start. I want to understand something. Who here is a really big Star Wars fan? Really big Star Wars fan? Okay, who among the really big Star Wars fans has not seen the most recent Star Wars movie? Right, okay. Yeah. Okay. This is the thing. So my opening illustration, this is pastoral care, because I do not want to ruin your Star Wars stuff. The opening illustration, the very end, wait, Eli, so excited. The very end of the Star Wars movie that came out in December. But after talking about it with Sam, it does not spoil the plot in any way. There's a cameo in this 2-minute segment of film, but it's not going to ruin your experience of the film. It's not going to give away plot any more than we already know. So let me set this up for just a minute. So I think the first Star Wars movie, chronologically for us humans, came out in 1977 or so. Is that right? Eli, you want to just come up here and give us a little background on it? He was like a puppeteer guy. 1977. Okay, so 1977, but that was really episode 4 in the series, right? So the Star Wars movie that just happened this December is a little tiny side story, a little chapter that supports the start of that very first movie. Okay, so probably most of you have seen the Star Wars from 1977. So in that very first Star Wars movie that I remember from being a little child, the bad guys, led by Darth Vader, have created a huge weapon, a planet called the Death Star. And in that first movie, the good guys, the rebels, dressed in white, the rebels conquered the Death Star. Okay, so everybody knows this. This information is over 40 years old, so nobody be mad. We were supposed to know. So they conquered the Death Star. They do that because they have plans that they have stolen for that Death Star. This final scene has to do with the last moments of retrieving those plans and getting them to the good guys.
Yeah. carefully secure the airlock. Prepare the escape pods. Your Highness, the transmission we received.
What is it they've sent us?
Help.
Hope within our lives. And when I was thinking about situations that require hope, I thought, you know, gosh, you would like to say as a Christian, I'm always hopeful. But what I realize is some situations require hope, like, you know, defeating the dark side. And some situations kind of don't require a whole lot of hope because you're pretty sure about them, right? Like if you ask me, what are you having for dinner tonight, Rachel? I'm going to tell you that I'm having salmon and quinoa and green beans for dinner. And if you say, do you hope that you're having that? I would say, no, I know that I'm having that, right? It's in my fridge, and we're having company, so I'm pretty sure I'm not going to, you know, bag out on the sofa and sleep through dinner and order pizza, right? I'm going to make that dinner. Am I hopeful? No, I know that. I'm sure about it. I understand it. I have control over all the variables that are required in making dinner for tonight. So that is not a situation where I'm just waiting in hope. But when we are confronted with a situation where we have less certainty and less control, that is when hope starts to become more important to us. Because what we're saying is, I can't control all the variables here. I'm not sure about the outcomes. And therefore, I need hope. Let's use a pretty easy every week example, getting to work, okay? Some people, like my husband, are fortunate to have, you know, he can show up to work anytime within a few hours of range. But other folks have to show up on time. Anybody have to show up on time to work or you're in trouble? Okay, right. You need to be there because your face is important to that game. Not that Sam's face, not important. Anyway. So you have to be there. So leaving on time is very important. And you have had this happen where you got up basically on time and everything was fine, but then you got fouled up somewhere in your routine. Like you got in the car and the gas was on empty, or you got in the car and remembered you had to bring a change of clothes, you have to run back in the house, you have to go get something, something messes up. And all of a sudden, when you turn the car on and the clock lights up, it's like 6 minutes behind where it needs to be. And you're like, oh, am I going to get to work on time? I hope I get to work on time. I hope I do. I can go this way or this way. And this way has right-hand turns but more stoplights. This has left-hand turns but fewer stoplights. I hope I'm choosing the right direction. I hope I don't get behind a school bus. I hope I don't get by the person driving 29 and 35. Because that's not okay with me. Don't ever do that to me, right? I will be right up in the bar. I hope I don't get behind a slow person. I hope there's not an accident in the way. I hope when I walk in the door, my boss is far away if I happen to be late and he does not see this, right? So many variables you can't control. And you focus on all those different points. If there's just no buses, if the lights are only green, if there's no accident, if my boss is away from the door, everything will be fine, right? These are the things we hope for that we can't control. I want to suggest to you that one of the main pitfalls that we have as Christians, but especially people out in the world, is that when we are in a situation of hoping for something, of not being in strong control of the situation, what we start to do is focus on all the things that we can see about the situation, all the variables. Like, I can get to work on time if the red lights, if my boss, right? These are all the things that we understand. And so we start to focus on those things that we understand, and we start to push on them, or you know, be like you have a slow driver in front of you, and so you honk your horn, you try to influence that, right? This is the thing that's in my way. If I want to be on time to work, I'm going to honk my horn, I'm going to zip around that car, right? And so we look at a bunch of things in front of us that we understand, and say, if those things work out right, I will get my hope. And what we do as Christians, even as people who love God so much, this is human tendency, is that we forget that these are just only the things that we can see and understand that have to do with the situation. And in fact, that there's something behind those things that is actually the author and source of what really happened. Right? We forget that God is behind that. It's like those big old TV sets. You remember the tube TV sets, the ones that to carry? These ones, you know what I'm talking about? Even the kids in the room know what I'm talking about, right? Kids? Tube TVs? Not the flat, not this kind, but this kind, right? Super deep. I still remember my sophomore year in college, my roommate, Emily, her, grabbing our TV that was like this big. This is a little girl. She's on the swim team. She's like a little twig. Grabs that TV. Must have weighed, what, 55 pounds or something. Had a VCR unit in it. It was kind of nice. Picks it up and runs it up four flights of stairs to our dorm room. Could not believe it. Those things were so heavy. But when you're watching TV on one of those tube TVs, you get all preoccupied in the image that's being projected on the glass, right? You're watching the Brady Bunch. You're watching Johnny Carson. Something old because it's a tube TV. Right? So you're watching it there, and that's what you think the main deal is about that TV, is the light that's shining on the screen. But in reality, there is a bulb in the back that is making that image. Do you see what I'm saying? We can get distracted or place priority on the things that we understand and we can see, and forget about the light source behind the things. And so when we start hoping, we can be distracted and start hoping about just these things instead of placing our hope in the light source. What about something more difficult than being on time to work? What about getting into college? A number of us may remember trying to apply and get into college. Some of us have kids who are now thinking about applying and getting into college. What you hope that your kid gets into the college that they want to go to. Let's put that out there. What things do you have to control? What are the elements that you need to line up in order for your kid to get into college? Somebody tell me. This is your turn.
Essay.
Okay, the kid's essay on the application.
Finances.
Yes, somebody right in the middle of it right now. Finances.
Grades.
Grades of the kid? Yeah.
References.
What's that?
References.
References, yeah.
Extracurricular activities.
Right, well-rounded student. By the way, if you ever want your kid to look good on their college application, talk to me and we'll give them a leadership role in the church, okay? I'm not kidding. I'm going to have to do a little work for it, but we will do that. So we'll go on their application. Absolutely. No, they gotta work. I'm not just giving it away. Yeah. Okay, so we have the kids' grades, we have the kids' application, we have the letters of reference coming from other people, we have finances, managing the finances of the situation. I think that's it too. Fine. So we know about these things and we say, I hope that my kid can get into the college that they want to go to. And so we kind of lean on the kid and make sure that the grades are coming as well. We lean on the kid again and make them write the essay. We lean on the kid again. Poor kid. Who are you going to get your letters of reference from? Wouldn't it be nice if you could find like an influential alumna of the college to write a letter? Wouldn't that really help? Or what if like your senator or your representative could write a letter? Like, that would be neat if you know some sort of high-ranking political person. Somebody with a little clout, a little swing in the world. Wouldn't that be fun if they could write a letter of reference? And what about the money? Well, you started the 529 a long time ago. Maybe some grandparents set aside some money, right? So you want to manage the money well. So you know about all of these things, and you say, I hope that my kid is getting into college. And let's say the kid does. Ta-da, now we're all happy. Thank you, Lord, that's wonderful. And let's say the kid doesn't.
This is our tendency. Well, what messed up there? Where was the mess up? What didn't go right? You know, I really do not like the manager of my 529. I think that guy mismanaged that money and I don't have as much money as him, and that might have helped. Or that letter of reference from that senator must have been all wrong and they didn't do well enough. Or my kids' teachers are grade too hard and the GPA went down just at the wrong moment of those teachers. Right? So we start getting mad at all the different elements because what we hoped for didn't work out. And when we do that, what we are showing is that we have placed our hope only in the small range of things that we understand. And we have not put our hope in God's will for our child. God can use all of the things that we understand to get what we hope for to happen if it's within God's will. God can use those. It's wise. It's not like forget about getting a good letter of recommendation. God can use those things. But the thing is, God sees so much more than we do about what the options are and what needs to happen and what God wants for us. When we say these things need to happen to work out, it's with this very limited human knowledge of what the possibilities are and what God's asking or wanting for our life. Why not place our hope in God, in the source of that life, and say, God, I'm open here. This is what I see. This is what I hope. I'm going to try with the things that you've given me. But God, I'm open. I'm open to the options that you bring. Kid of mine in college, that's one. What about a tough health situation? A tough health diagnosis? You know, you go to the doctor goes, I see something a little bit irregular here. We want to send you for some more tests. Oh, good. Bam! Right? Send you for some more tests. Might want to do a biopsy on something. And so you come to church, you put yourself or your friend in the prayer list, I have to go get a biopsy. And we're nervous, and we say, there's a doctor who can help me. There's maybe a second doctor who can help me. Boy, I am going to eat really healthy starting right now, right? I can control my diet. I am now going to exercise as much as I can. Like, you turn over a new leaf health-wise so fast because this is something you know about. This is something you can control. And you go to the doctor, and they give you that test, and they say, you got a clean bill of health, and you say, thank you, God, that's wonderful. Or they may say to you, it looks like the test has come back positive and we're going to need to talk about the treatment or not treatment. Where is your hope there? Are you angry now at the doctors? Are you raging at them? We want another opinion. We don't believe what they say. I don't know. You know, or are we angry at ourselves or the person who's sick? You didn't exercise enough. You always had a bad diet. You kept smoking longer than you knew that was bad for you. Are you going to get mad at the surface things? Or are you going to say, my hope is in God? My hope is in this God who created me, who created this whole universe, who loves us, the God from whom I came and to whom I return. This is where my hope rests. And the things on the surface, yeah, they're disappointing me. It's not what I saw. It's not what I dreamed. It's not what I hoped. But I rest my hope in God. Can we be people who are like the psalmist, who say, he will not grow tired or get weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow weak and tired, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. The things of the world are not what we place our hope in. We are not disappointed when they don't go the way that we want. We have placed our hope in God, and therefore can soar on wings like eagles.
Amen.
It's time for our offering. Let us pray. Lord God, help us to root our hope in you and in your love of us and not in specific outcomes. God, help us to trust you and grow into wonderful people of hope as a witness to this world. Please accept our offering as a way of our saying thank you to you. Bless it and multiply it to your service. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. few announcements this morning. I know that Sam and John are going to queue up for announcements, I think. But today is the first Sunday that you can order Easter lilies if you would like to order them in memory or honor of someone, or just because they're pretty and you want some to take home. Paul has the envelope. See, Paul, turn around. Paul's got it there in the back. And so make sure to do that. And done in 2 weeks?
This week and next week.
This week and next week are the only weeks. There'll also be a link in the email to order them as well. Let's see. Oh, two big events coming up in May that we're just getting queued up for: the mother-daughter tea on May 15th, the day after Mother's Day. Jill Wilkinson, if you want to raise your hand, wave your hand. She is the hostess for that event, and so if you want to help out, talk to Jill about that. And also the spaghetti extravaganza with talent show this year. So exciting. Camille Connor, Camille, where are you? They're right there. Is heading that up, and she's who you talk to if you would like to help. And Dante is heading up the talent show portion of that. Dante, wait. In case you love that. And so if you're interested, that is on May 6th. That's going to be so much fun. Really looking forward to those two things. A week from this coming Saturday is electronics recycling here at the church parking lot. We do this about twice a year. If you tell your friends and neighbors, people often are looking for a way to dispose of their old electronics. It's like $5 or $10, depending on how big the piece of electronics is. So that is on Saturday, April 8th. Sam, are you ready with your announcement?
Yes. John Wise and George Dow Sr., the old George, and I are going to, we're raising money for kids and families with pediatric cancer. It's a terrible cancer for lots of kids to have. It's various kinds, and so we're raising money to support them and their families. And we're doing that. There's a link in the email. You can see us after church. What we're going to do is we're going to shave our heads and our beards, and we'll do that at Gillette Stadium, and maybe we'll see Gronk.
Yes. So thank you for the three of you for showing that leadership and helping to raise money. I think you told me the team has raised $1,100 already, but the goal is $15,000.
That's right. And we have room for more participants. I think Eli was going to sign up too.
Eli's parents just paid extra money for that. Would, for the first couple minutes, please talk to someone you don't really know that well, that you're not sure of their name or just don't know where they live or something like that. Please talk to them first and then go find your friends to talk to them. Celebration and thanks. We have a thank you from Carolyn Costantino to those who donated to the cereal drive to the Emmaus House. And Carolyn, how much longer do we have to bring in cereal donations?
I'll wait until next Sunday. So if you can bring in cereal, and if you have cereal at your home and you're not going to be here Sunday, just send me a text or call me and I will come and pick it up. They're in desperate need of cereal for their food pantry. So if you have it, I'll come and get it. If not, bring it on Sunday, and then I'm going to make the trip up to Havel next week to deliver it.
All right, thank you. So until next Sunday. All right. Well, then let's stand for the benediction. May God, who is the light, the source of all of our hope, be with us until we meet again. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.